favor for the latest design. And at that period, the latest design was written in the Islamic civilization and was written specifically to critique the Greek civilization and the Greek science, and hence to abandon the Greek science. And I will show you the complete example exactly what part of the Islamic science was useful for this enterprise and how they were incorporated within the Renaissance science. And hence, I hope I will keep this myth about the Renaissance being the recapture of the Greek antiquity. The kind of evidence I will use is divided into several categories, and I want to share them with you. I will speak of direct transmission, meaning when we know the original book, we know the translation, and there is not that much dispute about that. And hence I will use that as a debate. I will also speak about less obvious transmission. I hope the screen is still coming up. When it goes off, remind me of it, so that I know. and that has been the kind of transmission that has been recently discovered, and it has not yet reached the secondary textbook. And it has not reached the public knowledge yet, just like all scientific production. When you find something very fresh, very new, you publish it usually in a specialized journal, and then it takes about 40 to 50 years before they become parts of textbooks in those impressions. And another 50 to another 60 years before they become common knowledge. That's why most of the ideas that I keep hearing about Islamic science and the role of religion and all of that, all of that are really 19th century ideas. But now I think they have come into circulation, and I hope that we can learn how to stop them. Then I will speak particularly about the relationship between the father of modern astronomy, Copernicus himself, and exactly what parts of Islamic astronomy he took and made use of to construct his own astronomy. But here, at the very beginning, I should immediately say that, just in case there are people on record and in the present world, that I do not know of a single astronomer from whom Copernicus borrowed mathematical theorems, who propagated the idea of heliocentric universe. All of the Muslim astronomers that I know of work within a universe that is geocentric, that focuses on the Earth at the center, but yet the mathematics that they deployed to solve very critical problems in the Greek tradition turned out to be extremely useful for Copernicus, and I hope I will go into these details that you can see. Finally, I can also make the argument, and I hope I will convince you with it, that if I were to take a scientific idea that were brought from Islamic civilization into the Copernican construction of astronomy, if I take them up, then that whole edifice of Copernican astronomy would collapse. Indeed, it would collapse, and I will show you that he himself was even struggling to understand that astronomy that he was borrowing, and that is our best proof that he was indeed borrowing. Here again, I will use the same slide I used in the earlier lecture, simply to the genre of transmission that was direct transmission. No two people will dispute that here we have the original Arabic text, we have the Latin translation, and except that we immediately begin to see that it generated for us two new terms, the algorithm and then the algebra, that were not to be found in the Greek tradition. And here immediately we begin to see this transfer going without the difference. extremely useful for the European Latin West, and then it was carried in, and that's what we finally see developing. But here again, I don't mean that we have a console without trying to fill another with the very same stone. I want to draw your attention. This is also the page from the translation of the Health and Latin, and this is the picture of how the eye gets to see me. But that's the purpose why I bring it. I want you to remember that there is also this manuscript that is kept at the British Library now. And again, it is by Open Heather, as you can easily read here. It is Tractati Handi, Hyperidis, Arabis. You don't even need to know that.
All of those circles in here, every single one of them has an Arabic name.
contrary to what we have inherited from the Greek tradition or the Indian tradition for that matter. I also gave you the full list of the solar hours proven to be more in motion, the rate of precession is completely different, the eccentricity of the sun was completely different because it was better weather now, the equation of the sun was completely different. And then I asked you earlier today, I said, what is left of astronomy? If I take away the precession, I take away the inclination of the ecliptic, I take away the solar hour, I take away the eccentricity, I take away the equation, this is astronomy. So if we take all of that great material away, what is that? Hence, I also stressed the fact that when people discovered that this early Greek material was full of those kinds of mistakes, they gained this confidence that now they can construct science. They can make better science because they can make better observations, and the observations are ready at hand. And let me show you the basic question that went in their mind is that what else is wrong in the Greek tradition? If the fundamentals are wrong, maybe the original cosmology is also wrong. And they begin to raise this kind of question. They found that in the Greek tradition, yes indeed, the most superior, the most sophisticated Greek text is that of the Almanac of Ptolemy, in which he describes the behavior of the planets as we are sitting, he says, here at the center of the Earth, and the planet is carried by a small epicycle right in here, and the epicycle itself is within the shell of this blue sphere here. And then he adds that this blue sphere rotates in place, meaning it has to stay in its place with a global sphere, a rigid sphere, but it does not rotate uniformly, neither on an axis that goes through its center, nor on an axis that goes through the center of the bigger quadrant, but on an axis that's called the equant. And most of astronomers who saw this for the first time, they said, this is utter nonsense. Let me show you why it is nonsense. I'm sure you have seen the phenomena of modern basketball players who can spin a ball on their finger right there, and the ball will stay in spinning as long as their finger is pointing to the axis of the sphere. Notice what happens when the finger is moved off from the axis. See, the sphere collapses. The Greek system was telling us that the sphere will stay there even though the finger is not pointing at the axis. I will repeat it for those who have not noticed it the first time. Notice when the finger is moved off the axis, it collapses. Therefore, and this by the way, this configuration that I take you back to it, this configuration permeates Greek astronomy. It is in every single model that is constructed to describe the behavior of the planet. It has a physical contradiction of this nature. So you can imagine people immediately saying, this astronomy is not describing the physical world. It is not describing the world around us. So therefore it is a fiction in the brain. And as a matter of fact, I can have them say, you can imagine in your brain as much as you want that this line moves in this fashion, that sphere moves in this fashion, but it remains only in your imagination if it doesn't describe the real planets out there and the real behavior. And hence, you have to trust the observations and you have to have the mathematics that describes the observations consistent with the behavior of the observation. That is science. This is the step that I think the fundamental step to say, abandon the imaginary Greek science, now let us build science on real foundations and get rid of this kind of absurdity. And let me show you what kind of absurdity that led to. In the behavior of the movement of the I put my hand right in front of my finger, it covers the whole auditorium. Does that mean that my hand is bigger than the auditorium? It simply means that my hand is too close to my eye. Now, this component of how distinct is the object to be seen and what is the value of the observed object is an extremely important function, and we will see it out. In Ptolemy says, in order to straighten to calculate the longitude of the moon, you have to follow it at this passage, but then he forgot that at 90 degrees here, he says the moon will be brought closer to the earth because he needed to account for an angle in here of observing. And then he says it will be only 39 minutes. Why? Because it is full moon, it is 60 units away, or it is a new moon, it's also 60 units away. Okay. Follow the following guide. If an object is brought halfway from where it was, 60 units compared to 39 is almost halfway. When an object is brought halfway, it should at least look twice as big. And that means if I draw it to scale, the moon at 90 degrees should be that size compared to the moon when it is a full moon. Ibn Shah said, well, I'm good at that. I have never seen the moon at quarter moon look twice as big as it when it is a full moon. Therefore, it is absurd. What this model of Ptolemy is doing is absurd. Therefore, I have to create a new mathematics. This is the shadow of Damascus, who died in the year 1375, and this is the model that he proposed. And notice in the model of Abishadar, the center of the epicycle remains fixed, and hence the same distance of the moon, more or less, so we can see that the moon at full moon or quarter moon is still the same object that we see. It doesn't distort that observation, and it is for the need of that observation. Some people keep thinking that the studying astronomers were doing this for philosophical reasons, which is true, but they were also doing it for really concrete scientific reasons, i.e. to account for the observation. And now he said, I can account for this maximum angle that Ptolemy saw in here by actually mounting another epicycle on top of it, and here I have a bigger angle that will also justify the observation. Perfect solution. Gets rid of the physical absurdities, gets rid of the conceptual contradictions, and it creates the new mathematics to explain the phenomena as we exactly see it. Look at this model that is written here, and that comes from the words of Copernicus in 1543, who died, that is about 150 years after Abishad. Line for line, circle for circle, epicycle for epicycle, the same mechanism exactly rendering the work of Abishad. When Mario Bauer saw this for the first time in 1957, he said, peculiar, strange, it is impossible to construct two models identical get the outer sphere moving at this speed, the inner one, which is half the size, moving backwards at the same, at twice the speed, and the point of tangency, this red one, you will see it will oscillate up and down the diameter of this. And if I should thank Ali Nouri of London for creating these animations for me, so you can visually see that there is a circular motion that is creating linear motion as we see. And this is the Cauchy problem that Cauchy problem has proven in the original work of Civilization-3. Actually, Civilization-3 was demonstrating. If I stop it right here and compare now this concoction that you see here, and that is the concoction in Civilization-3. So he was indeed trying to prove the death. When Copernicus takes the whole model of Fermi-Schade for murdering, he incorporates all of this model, and yet he doesn't seem to understand what it is. And this is the statement of Copernicus himself. You see again the excessive light condition, they make these things that are in red. I don't know if you can see them in red. But what he says here, the combination of circuits, this is what Copernicus is saying about the mercury model. He's he says, you know, there is this big one, I want to get rid of it. The best way to do it is to insert a new little epicycle that itself will carry the center of the larger epicycle, and then I can account for it, he said, by creating this new field that will tell me that if I take this eccentricity in half, i.e. the size of this line here, to be equal to this line, and if I take the angles to be the same, then the edges here will always be better. And that will actually give me an account of the import of economy, and it will save the phenomena, meaning save the observations at the same time, make it more systematic with the cosmology that they propose. Now we come, not to Copernicus, we come to Kepler, about 50 years later. Kepler was reading.
Why is this
transmission that happens when an intelligent person, knowledgeable in the subject matter, is reading a manuscript in the original language, and now he is commenting on it in Latin, meaning he is capable of understanding the Arabic and he doesn't need it to be translated for him. That immediately spurred my interest as to who is this guy? Who is this person who could do all of that and write it for me? The librarian of the Vatican, may his soul also rest in peace, by the name of Giorgio Bellarina, has written a book in 1938 which he called it The Origins of All the Oriental Manuscripts that are kept in the Vatican Library. So I got to that book, I looked Vatican Arabo 319, who is the person who brought it to the library, and he tells me it is a man by the name of Leon Postel, whose face that you don't see here. If we have time, I can also come back to Pakistan and teach a whole semester on Leon Postel. He's an extremely interesting Frenchman, contemporary with Copernicus. He was born in 1510 and died in 1581, so younger contemporary, overlapped with Copernicus, and tells us what these Renaissance men were doing. So I began to flip the Sirwalid manuscripts that were owned by this Leon Postel. There is one that is kept at the Bibliothèque Nationale in Paris, 2449, and it is not explicitly here, it said ex-Libris Leon Postel, as you see, the man owned it, and he wrote it by the title of it. And it also says, when you flip the first two pages, turning over, it says, Leon Postel is Constantinople, and it's here, the year 1536, don't let this confuse you, that's number five in the Renaissance time. It's 1536, and we know that Leon Postel was indeed in Constantinople in the year 1536 to conclude a treaty, to help the conclusion of a treaty between the king, François Ier of Paris, and the king of the Sultan Suleiman the Magnificent in Istanbul, so that they have a treaty among themselves to fight whom? Charles V, the Roman Emperor, the Holy Roman Emperor. So for European wars, for European problems in the 16th century, Leon Postel was sent to Constantinople. He used the occasion to buy Arabic manuscript. This Arabic manuscript here, you know, this is Kitab Muntahat, it is a pure planetary theory, Arabic text by Arabic. And when I flipped through it, I began to see that these annotations are all over the place, that it is not limited to one place. Because he managed to conclude the treaty, by the way, he was rewarded when Leon Postel came back to Paris. King François Ier appointed him as professor of mathematics and oriental languages and what is now called Collège de France. Collège de France is the most important academic institution in France, if not in Europe altogether. And it is, if you get appointed in that position, you will only be rubbing shoulders with the angel and not the fellow faculty and faculty. So this man was rewarded. Hence, he is not a trivial astronomer, he is not a trivial professor, he is one of the most important professors of the Renaissance period. And look what he is doing with this marginalia on this Arabic manuscript, and even to prove that he was also indeed knowledgeable in what he was doing, he noticed that in this page, that there was a mistake in this page. Where is the mistake? This one gives the names of the Hijra month, as you see, the names of the Arabic month of the Islamic time, the names of the months in the Syriac tradition, the names of the months in the Persian tradition, and then the names of the months in the Hebrew tradition. And then you notice you go Tishri, Matash, Bam, Kislev, Shabbat, and then you have Shabbat, Nisan. There is no Adar in between them. There is a mistake. So what does he do? He corrects the mistake. In here he inserts Adar, but he rewrites the names in Hebrew, as you see them over there. And now I can say, on the basis of this evidence alone, that his mastery of Arabic was better than his mastery of Hebrew. Why? Hebrew vowel system is much more complicated than Arabic because it has voices similar to O, E, very excessive E, A, the long A. Arabic has only A, O, or A. It doesn't have all of the six, seven vowels of Hebrew. So he doesn't know the vowels. So what does he do? He writes it in Hebrew, transliterates it to Arabic, puts the vowels in Arabic to teach you how to read it. You see what he was doing? And this is my proof that he knew the vowel system of Arabic, how to control Arabic, much better than he knew how to control Hebrew. And hence, now we are talking about a very intelligent human being who was contemporary with Copernicus and study this Arabic manuscript that I have just shown you, taking notes on the margins at night, and the next morning delivering the lectures that they collect the front. What is the name of the science that pours out of the mouth of the young Muslim? Shall I call it Arabic because he was studying it in Arabic the night before? Shall I call it Latin because he was simply repeating the ideas he learned the night before in Latin? Or shall I call it Greek because the original Arabic was written for opposition to the Greek and now he was copying the opposition into Latin? All of this to show you that science does not believe in identity of culture and identity of religions and identity of languages and chauvinistic nationalism. Science bypasses all of this and seeks solution. And what Guillaume Pasteur was doing, he was exhibiting for us the complexity of scientific idea invented by the Syrian Tusi, the Tusi couple, where he spoke Persian at home, he wrote it in Arabic, it gets translated into the Latin only by osmosis and not translated text by text. blood and the smaller circulation is then the foundation for it is right here. But they have no response. They said an official writing between Damascus and Cairo about the year 1241 in writing here. The same statement is made by my conservative in 1553 on that of Copernicus. And also by the other Colombo, 1559, who died a little bit after Copernicus. Again, and by the father, of modern anatomy, Vesalius himself. Vesalius also comes to Padua in 1537. He writes his first edition of the anatomy of the body, and it is in the second edition that is published in 1555 that Vesalius said, I still do not see how even the smallest quantity of blood can be transfused through the substance of the septum from the right ventricle to the left. This is the same. He is the father of modern anatomy, by the way. And all of this is happening in time. If you have time and you have time for questions, I would like to talk as much as I can about Bible, which will take another semester. But thank you for your attention, and I hope I can make that all in the time. I hope that I have convinced you that with the succession of those two works, the one in the morning and the one in the morning, that we can lay to rest all of this mythology about Arabic science preserving. You see how deeply critiqued the Greek science and how deeply reconstructed. Not only they added a blemish here, a blemish here, and fixed it. They fundamentally changed the whole way we look at science. They reconstructed all science that way. And indeed now it makes sense why the Renaissance and we're seeking that science because it is the latest science, the most up-to-date science, and it's widely made useful to people like Copernicus, to people like Leonardo, to people like Vesalius, and if you don't want, I can just all the Renaissance scientists who are using this material. Thank you again, and I think that is it. This time I will not tell it off, I will keep it just in case somebody wants to share it and then explain it in one of the slides. I can think that it will work. If there are any questions, I think I will gladly look at your answer if I can. But I think the gentleman.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I am Naimar Dandishi from PU International Relations Department. Sir, I am waiting after your lectures, but I am concluding a question by that on both your lectures. Sir, the Muslims have done very important works and also healthy communities, not any discrimination. But now the modern era, the Muslim and many poor nations are a lot of problems, and many developed nations must be shared their fruit of technology, information technology and science. They can help the poor nations with the transfer of the knowledge. So my question is that why the developed country, especially
is a mechanism, there is a cultural tradition. Second, there is also an awareness in the cultural awareness that when a culture knows its own history and takes pride in its own history, and it also creates symbol for its history, those things become symbol. And then we refer to them as Newton's first law. Newton's element, isn't it? But the nature of Islam is to get attached to this as a kind of signpost in the culture of the Muslim. We should be able, children of Islamic culture should also be able to do the same thing. And I hope that from now on, we can think, we need to think when we teach our students astronomy of the creativity of Mushabe. We should say this is the Mushabe solution. This is why you begin an early theory. Actually now, the Tusi couple, we call it the Tusi couple. I call it the early lemma. I don't say it's the lemma of the two parallel lines. I give the name of the scientist who produced it. Slowly, slowly, together with the lip. But all of these findings that I'm sharing with you today were all started after 1957. And I began to work on Hermes' work in 1977. I left Mishada to complete early, and now I resume with Mishada, and now the Mishada had come down because I wanted to produce something. Those scientists are so many of them, and we are all in a hurry and in a rush to see which one takes priority. I put that on. But at some point we should digest this material, have it go into our own secondary teaching books, so that gets into the freshman book, so that our own students begin to realize how important those people were in constructing this very foundational science, systematic science, consistent science, based on their own observations and in their belief in their own observations. And to construct the theories on the basis of the slowly, slowly, hopefully, we will catch up and empower this history, rather than be convinced by the colonial vision of it, that it is not worth remembering. We should always look forward to it. Not reminding you that forward always means a good grasp of your history. All the Western nations, they look forward, but they never let you forget the great Greek miracle, which was founded 1,500 years earlier. They picked that history and they projected onto the future that they would always be that great. So the history really projects the future in that sense. And we haven't learned how to do this because we have lost the identity under the colonial existence. I think colonialism is so damaging. It damages the psyche much more than simply excluding the resources from them than they bring to the population. There is a gentleman in the back who has a hand. Oh, and there is a microphone right next to you. Yes. Speak slowly so that you are too far from me. I hope I can hear you.
Yes. I am a student and I am asking you a question with a student of mine. I think that Muslims are still have the caliber and potential to advance in the science and technology. But I think that the Englishmen, I think the people like in America or in England or in etc. countries, they don't like to see the Muslims ahead of their. So they are pressing the Muslims in this field. I give you an example of my own country that I think that Mr. Abdul Qadir Khan is also have the caliber to achieve the Nobel.